Good afternoon. I'm Kathleen Vermillion, sitting in temporarily for Steve Sanson, who's on his way to the station. We have Board of Regent Ron Knecht on the phone. Hi, Ron. Are you there?
Hello.
Hi. Hi, it's Kathleen Vermillion. How are you? Thank you for joining us today.
Good to talk to you, Kathleen.
Mr. Sanson is on his way over.
Okay.
Why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself? I gave a brief introduction about your role on the Board of Regents, but why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself and what it is that you do?
Well, thank you for the opportunity, and thanks also to our veterans in politics. It's good to be talking with you all today. I have a background as an economist, and I also went to law school, but don't hold that against me. I've also got a background in engineering, so higher education has really been good to me and really important to our family. I've been a Nevadan by choice since 2001, when we became California refugees, and we're raising our 10-year-old daughter over here, and that's a really good thing.
Mm-hmm.
Originally, I'm a small-town boy from Illinois, where I went to the University of Illinois, began my graduate work there, and later on did my graduate studies at Stanford and law school at the University of San Francisco. And about a year after I got to Nevada, a seat opened up in the Assembly, and I got elected to the Assembly. And so in the 2003 session, I was one of the so-called Mean 15. We stood against...
We remember.
Yeah, it's hard to forget that one. We stood against the gross receipts tax. Successfully, we couldn't stop all the tax increases, but we stopped the worst of it. Then I was hard targeted for having been one of the leaders of that, and I lost my seat in the Assembly. And I actually planned to go back and reclaim that in 06, but the seat on the Board of Regents opened up, and I said, you know, that sounds like a much more interesting thing to do. And so I've spent 5 years, 3 months, and 20 days on the Board of Regents, and greatly enjoyed it.
Well, let's talk a little bit more about that, Ron. Where is it exactly in Nevada that you reside? I know that you represent a district or a ward, but you also, in your role as a board member for the Nevada System of Higher Education, you also have to represent a statewide constituency. So where is it that you reside? And let's talk a little bit about the differences of being a regent in comparison to an assembly elected official.
Good idea. First of all, I reside here in Carson City on the far west side, where the mountains suddenly rise up out of the desert, with my wife, our daughter, and my mother-in-law, who's going to be 91 shortly and is the best mother-in-law in the world.
Happy birthday to her.
Yes, thank you. I'll tell her. The district includes Carson City, Douglas County, Lyon County, Story County, right now, and the south end of Washoe County, up to the south part of Reno, but I'm losing a little bit of the Washoe County territory in the new district, but I'm picking up Churchill, Lander, Esmeralda, and Mineral County, so I guess you could consider this one of the two so-called rural districts.
Sounds like a very large district that as well.
Yeah, and it's a challenge to campaign in a large district like that, but it's one I'm enjoying.
What are some of the fundamental differences? And let's talk a little bit more, expand a little bit on the recent controversy over yet again another tuition rate increase in order to help the state Board of Regents balance their budget. And how
right.
did you vote on that issue?
Well, I voted against the last increase, and I'll explain it this way. When I got on the board, we had one of the highest taxpayer funding ratios, taxpayer to student funding ratios in the country. Students were paying only about 20 to 25, less than 25% of the cost of their undergraduate education if they were in state, and taxpayers were picking up the rest of it. So I didn't find it unreasonable to up the student percentage a little bit, but we kept piling on and pancaking one increase after another, and the last round I said no, and I led the opposition to it, but unfortunately we came up a few votes short, and so they had one more 8% increase. What I can tell you is that we're still one of the low-cost and high-value options at the University of Nevada, Reno, and University of Nevada, Las Vegas, among our peers. So we're doing okay, but I think you're suggesting, and you're right, that the issue is balance, and you can't just keep running up tuition and fees forever.
And simultaneously giving the majority of your workforce pay increases, whether they be whether they be longevity raises or cost of living raises or what have you. I mean, why would the, even the taxpayers, I mean, what justification did the majority of the board have, and I wish I would have sat in on that meeting, in saying that we need to give our employees pay raises, and yet we feel comfortable doing it on the back of the taxpayers and or worse yet, the students.
Yeah, exactly right. And I guess they'd have to speak for themselves as to what justification they have. But the normal justification is that we're in a competitive market, and we have to pay the market-going salaries. The fact of the matter is, and this is some of the research that I've done independently and publicized, we actually have relatively high pay for our faculty compared to the other states, and especially the other western states. So I think I'm grateful for what the faculty do, and I support them, but I think we've got to rein that in just a little bit in these hard times. Everybody else is taking it on the chin, and I don't mean that the faculty should take it on the chin, but we shouldn't tax the taxpayers further and burden the students and their families further in order to keep the faculty rates of pay going up the way they were.
All right, thank you for that. And then, Ron, what's in the future for you? What are you going to serve another term on the Board of Regents? And
Well, I sure hope so. I'm running for re-election, and I have two opponents, and I will have no bad words to say about them. They're good people. Both of them taught for 28 years and one for 33 years at our Western Nevada Community College up here, and both of them were forced to take the buyout in the last round of budget cuts. So my first words to them are thank you for your many years of service and the good job you've done. What's I hope's in the future for me is re-election to the board, so I can continue to do the kind of work I've done, fighting to keep our community colleges intact, fighting to keep cooperative extension intact, and above all, fighting to have some balance and get out of the north-south battles. You know, we appointed a president yesterday, a permanent president for the University
of
Nevada.
Who is it? Go ahead and tell the listeners who that person is.
That's Mark Johnson, who'd been the interim president at the University of Nevada, Reno. And the campaign for him was somewhat divisive and set us back in terms of unity and getting over the North-South battles. And quite frankly, in this case, it was the North that was really at fault. So I spoke up and I said that on the record yesterday, even as I voted for Professor Johnson. But that's one of the battles we have to fight, is to get over the internecine warfare and take a statewide viewpoint.
And that's something that we've been working on for many, many years.
That's right. That's right. And we've got to continue working on it. I will tell you this. When I ran for the board 6 years ago, I told the Reno Gazette Journal editors that one of my goals was to help the board and the system shed the word dysfunctional from their title. You may recall that you didn't read a news story in those days about the Board of Regents without it being called the Dysfunctional Board of Regents. And about a year and a half ago, when John Ralston gave a speech up here, I asked him in public afterwards, John, when was the last time you said or wrote anything about the dysfunctional Board of Regents? And he looked at me and he laughed and said in front of the whole audience, he said, not since Ron Knecht was elected to the board.
Mr. Ralston sure is witty, and he has a fantastic sense of humor. Yep. Well, we're going to go ahead and cut to a break. You're more than welcome to stay online and join us for our future interviews, or if not, we really appreciate your time today, and best of luck to you on that reelection bid.
Thank you, Kathleen. I sure appreciate it.
Thank you, Ron.
I'll stay and listen.
All right. We'll talk to you soon.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, listen up. If you're a military veteran, if you're related to a veteran, or if you know a veteran, you'll enjoy the Veterans Reporter radio show every Thursday from 8 p.m. to 9 p.m. with me. I'm your host, Chuck N. Baker. Every week, we will explore veterans' issues and we'll have guests who will talk about topics of interest to and about the veterans community. And if you don't listen, you'll have to give me 20 push-ups.
This public service announcement is brought to you by Veterans in Politics International. The Veterans in Politics mission is to teach, educate, organize, and awaken our veterans and their families to select, support, and vote intelligently for a better world, and to protect ourselves from our own governments and a culture of corruption, and to be the political voice for those in other groups that do not have one.
There are too many homeless veterans, and more help is needed from the VA. Every veteran service organization post should adopt a local homeless veteran.
The funding of VA medical centers is inadequate, and building a VA hospital in Southern Nevada is moving at a slow pace. The budget has been flatlined for too many years. The VA is too quick to deny claims and too slow to help veterans gather records in support of claims.
Local politicians ignore veterans and their issues. They perceive a lack of organization among their local veterans and that it won't hurt them at election time. Veterans too often vote party, not veteran issues. All veterans should vote in every election.
The news media give an adequate coverage to veteran issues and events. You must send letters to the editor and voice this concern.
Please contact your members of Congress and Senate and urge them to co-sponsor key legislation in supporting our veterans.
Please support Veterans in Politics. And to get more information, go to www.veteransinpolitics.com.
Hello, my fellow Nevadans. Are you tired of listening to the same old rhetoric from politicians? I know I am. And that's why I'm running for Congress in Nevada's 4th District as a conservative. I'm Sidney Zeller, a retired Marine Corps Lieutenant Colonel and veteran of 3 wars. I'm a proven leader and a man of honor, integrity, and character. My focus is on bringing economic prosperity to the 4th District. For more information on my positions, please visit my Facebook and website, SidZellerForCongress.com. Paid for by Sid Zeller for Congress.
Join Alexia, Sierra, Calypso, and Sweet Cheeks for a no-holds-barred show on VegasAllNetRadio.com, the curvaceous bounty of Sin City, where we talk about dating, love, life, and sex. Tune in Sundays from 7 p.m. to 10 p.m. Are you brave enough? The curvaceous bounty of Sin City. Visit us at SinCityBounty.com.
Mr. Sanson has arrived in the studio, so I am going to check out for a few minutes and allow him to conduct his regular radio business, and I will tune back in shortly. Thank you.
Oh, my goodness. I don't even know how to operate these microphones anymore. This is Steve Sanson with Veterans in Politics. Jim Jonas won't be here today, so Kathleen Vermillion graciously decided that she was going to co-host for him, and we appreciate that. You know something? The 95 freeway has shut down to one lane. One lane on the 95 freeway shut down to one lane north of Cheyenne, and the only lane that's open, somebody decides to have an accident. So there's traffic blocked up everywhere. So if you're on the 95 freeway and you live north of Cheyenne, you probably want to avoid that particular stretch of highway, because I tell you, it was a madhouse trying to get to the studio today. But there's something that came up, and I need to address this. This is about District Court Judge Alicia Kadish. She was selected for an appointment to the federal bench by U.S. Senator Harry Reid, and she was nominated by the President of the United States to be the next federal judge for the state of Nevada. And she was supposed to be going in front of the Senate Judiciary Committee for the appointment process. And Senator Dean Heller decided that he was not going to support her because of a questionnaire that Judge Kadish did back in 2008 with Citizens for Responsible Government. So basically, I just want to read to you a letter, or a little part of a letter that I obtained that was written by District Court Judge Alicia Kadish to U.S. Senator Harry Reid. And the letter goes like this. You have asked for clarification regarding my response to questions in a questionnaire from Citizens for Responsible Government, which I completed on May 2008. The question asks, I want to assure you that I was not given my personal opinion on this question. Rather, this response was based on my understanding of state of federal law at the time. To the extent the law was unsettled in the area, I also indicated as a judge, I will follow the law subsequently as a result if asked the same question today. Basically, the question was asked back in 2008 if Judge Kadish believed it was a constitutional right to bear arms. And back in 2008, Judge Kadish answered the question saying that she does not believe it was a constitutional right at that particular time based on how the law was written, and that she was not given her personal opinion. All she would be doing would be enforcing the law as it exists. And now in 2012, basically it is a constitutional right to bear arms. So she again said she now believes that based on the way the law is written today, it is a constitutional right to bear arms, and that she would enforce the law as it is written. So now we got a judge that wants to enforce the law and not legislate from the bench, but our Senator Dean Heller has a problem with that. Probably basically maybe the Nevada, maybe the NRA is breathing down his neck. Maybe the ultra conservatives are breathing down his neck. But I don't understand why would we deny a judge from the federal bench who actually is going to do exactly what we want the judge to do, which is to enforce the law and not legislate from the bench, not give a personal opinion of the law, but to enforce the law as written. And we have a problem with that. So I understand what's going on. And I understand that Senator Heller is using Judge Kadish as a political pawn to gain conservative votes on falsehoods. And I just want to reach out to Senator Heller, because I also sent this press release that went out last night, this morning. I also sent a copy to Senator Heller, and I wanted to understand that the Veterans in Politics International is made up of a lot of folks that believes in the Constitution and the right to bear arms. In fact, a lot of us are concealed weapon carriers, and we endorsed Judge Kadish back in 2008, along with 22 other judicial candidates, and successfully 18 of them are now sitting judges today, and we endorsed in the primary. But we would have not have endorsed Judge Kadish for this position if we did not believe that she would A, enforce the law as written, B, not legislate from the bench, and C, enforce and support the Constitution of the United States. So for that, I would like everybody to reach out to Senator Dean Heller's office and put a call into him and ask him if he could go ahead and clarify exactly why he's blocking Judge Kadish, because according to what Judge Kadish is saying is that she would enforce the law, and back in 08, it was not a constitutional right to bear arms, but now it is, and she would enforce the law either way, and she's not giving her own personal opinion. So based on that, I believe, and I'm sure there's a lot of other folks believe, that Judge Kadish should move forward with her appointment or nomination to be selected as the next federal judge for the United States, represent the state of Nevada. With that said, I am going to go ahead and take a commercial break and bring on our next guest. Our next guest is Rose Moore. She's a radio host for All Talk Radio, candidate for Clark County School Board Trustee District B, and a Veterans in Politics International Endorsement recipient. This is Steve Sanson and Kathleen Vermillion with Veterans in Politics. Don't go away, folks.
Hello, my name is Steve Sanson. I'm the president of Veterans in Politics International. This country and state are in trouble with budget cuts, unemployment, foreclosures, teacher shortage, dropout rates, terrorism, and a loss of military service members. The outcome of this election will profoundly affect families, both military and non-military. Military men and women are dying for other countries to have the right to vote. As a former member of the United States Marine Corps and the Army, I know how important it is to keep the voters informed. Log on to the website veteransinpolitics.com. All Americans of voting age need to not only vote, but research your choices. The Veterans in Politics organization has taken a proactive approach to supporting candidates who will have the courage to protect all of our freedoms and our Constitution. Visit our website at veteransinpolitics.com. Don't just talk about who you support. Research your choices and vote.
Hello, SS Navigator has arrived. Many people wait for their ship to come in, but they are at the airport. Don't miss this ship known as the SS Navigator, which could mean steamship or could mean the Social Security Navigator. Heard on VegasAllNetRadio.com.
This is Don DeHaar. Join me for the Social Security Navigator program every Wednesday at 6 p.m. Pacific Time.
Not affiliated with any government agency.
Veterans in Politics takes a proactive approach to provide you, the veteran, with the political voice for which you fought and served.
Veterans in Politics is becoming the premier veteran organization of the 21st century, with political candidate interviews, insight, and endorsements.
Public speaking engagements in support of American values.
Radio shows to keep you updated on the latest in veteran and military support operations.
Providing job placement and business support.
Go to veteransinpolitics.com today and do your part in defending liberty.
Sweet Cheeks with the curvaceous bounty of Sin City. In this election year, knowledge is power. Know the issues, know the candidates, and remember to vote. Your vote is your voice. And besides, you get a really cool sticker.
While growing up, I've always asked my family, who is my father? I was told the name of a man. When I became older, I looked for this man and found him. He thought that I was his son as well. But after a DNA test, it was discovered that my family was lying to me all my life. I pressured my family to give me the real identity of my father. I then became suspicious and took my grandfather's DNA. After I buried my grandfather, 2 days later, I discovered that my grandfather was, in fact, my biological father. I questioned myself and asked, what is my purpose on this earth? I should have never been conceived. But when I look at my four children, I knew that everything happens for a reason. This is Steve Sanson. Find your identity.
Hey, you. This is Vince here on the Talk with Vince show, where no subject is off the table. We'll explore the depths of your mind.
Spirituality, we talk it. Enlightenment, we talk it. Politics, we talk that too. Ufology, you want it, you got it. Conspiracy facts, we're on it. Sex, we talk it. So join me every Saturday from 11 a.m. to 12 p.m. for Talk with Vince. Here on VegasAllNetRadio.com. Talk that will blow your mind.
Americans have been fooled by politicians about illegal immigration. They make you think that if you bring up this topic, you are a racist. Did you know that America is the only country on this planet that does not enforce its federal immigration laws? For the fear of being called a racist, I am for legal immigration. I was born on the island of Jamaica, became an American citizen, served 12 years in the U.S. military, served in Desert Storm, and received a Presidential Unit Citation, National Defense Medal, and Marine Corps Commendation. Our immigration laws serve a purpose. I understand that this country was founded on immigration, but there is a wrong way and a right way. I'm here to tell you that illegal immigration is breaking our federal laws. Why don't you call me a racist? This is Steve Sanson.
My name is Sean Havlin, United States Army 1st Ranger Battalion. I've been wounded in Iraq and Afghanistan, and I'm supporting Kenneth Wagner for Congress. Ken is an Army veteran who was wounded in the first Gulf War, and his son is fighting in Afghanistan. When you go to WagnerForCongress.com, you will see that he is the only candidate running for Congress who refuses all money from lobbyists, PACs, and special interest groups. Like Ken, I believe our government needs to take the leash off our soldiers or bring them home and place them on our borders to help win the war on drugs. In Iraq, we used foreign-made equipment. Now, who do you think will make a better product to help protect our soldiers? Foreign factories or American factories? Kenneth Wagner's right. All government contracts should be made in the USA, creating jobs for our economy. To prove that Rangers lead the way, I am donating $500 to Kenneth Wagner. You too can make a difference. Donate what you can, tell your friends, get involved.
I'm Colonel Ed Bridges, United States Air Force retired. I'm supporting Kenneth Wagner.
I'm Sergeant Matt Penny, a former Recon Marine.
This is Dick Marcinko, Commander of the United States Navy, founder of SEAL Team 6 and Red Cell. I'm an American. I'm for Ken Wagner.
My name's Kenneth Wagner, and I authorize this message.
We're back. This is Steve Sanson with Veterans in Politics and former City Councilwoman Kathleen Vermillion. We're here live with Rose Moore.
Hey.
Hi, Rose.
Hi. How you doing, everybody?
Rose, could you give us a little background about yourself?
I only have half an hour. I have a degree in early childhood education with a minor in psychology. I have another degree in business management with a minor in law. I graduated from UCLA with my teaching credential. I have kudos all over the place. I've been advocating for disabled kids for 39 years all over the United States and now concentrating here in Nevada. Let me see. I was with the SEAC, Special Education Advisory Council. I am with many organizations, traumatic brain injury, autism, ADHD, deaf and blind, belong to all of those organizations, nationwide and local. I do IEPs for parents who call me because the school district won't listen.
So you're a special ed teacher as well?
I'm not a special ed teacher. I'm not a doctor and I'm not an attorney. But
like an MFT maybe?
No, I'm an advocate.
She's a wonderful advocate at that.
Yes,
I've been around a long time and done some wonderful things for the children, not just in this community, but other communities.
Yeah, and I think in the 38 years I've made $3,000. I don't usually charge anybody. And I've traveled all over the United States.
$3,000, 38 years.
Yep.
What'd you do with all the money?
I ate.
Rose, you ran for you're current candidate for Clark County School Board Trustee, correct?
Exactly.
And you ran for this position before?
No.
No, you didn't?
No.
What was that position you ran last time?
I didn't.
You didn't run?
No, that was my co-host.
I could have swore you was running.
Nope.
That sometimes wasn't you. It feels like you are, even when you're not, when you're that close.
When you're
to someone.
So involved, you know, when you put on the forum, you know, with Veterans in Politics and stuff, I was one of the people on the forum.
Oh, you sat on the panel with us?
Yes, I sat on the panel.
Okay.
You asked me to, so I said, oh, yeah.
So, why are you running for this position?
Clark County School District is a mess. I'm sick and tired of the trustees running the district running the trustees as if they were the boss, and the trustees are not educated. They don't have the knowledge. They don't have the experience to really take a look at what's best for the kids. And that, and in the whole picture, it isn't just the curriculum. It isn't just how they behave in class. It's also the money aspect of it. I review the purchase orders, change orders, and contracts every 2 weeks. And
That's a lot of reading.
Oh, yeah. But when you've had a construction background and a purchasing background, and you have the degrees that I have, it's very easy to do, and you know what to look for immediately.
So you're running against who?
Chris Garvey.
Okay. And Kevin Donovan is running against...
Deanna Wright.
Deanna Wright, that's right.
And Holloway is running, too.
Okay. So what are you going to do different that hasn't been done?
Kick ass. No, I'm very serious.
How you plan on doing that?
For 14 years now, I've been going to these meetings and appearing before the podium. And as you know, I have a radio show as well. And anything I say in front of the podium, in front of public record, or on my show, we have documentation right in our hands. That's why we've never been sued, because they're afraid of me.
So let me ask you something. Why isn't the school board trustee meetings taped?
Taped?
Videotaped.
They're on internet.
They're on the internet.
Yeah, they're on.
So they're actually being taped.
Yes, they are. But what
I was told
do,
that they weren't taped.
Yeah, they are.
They are taped.
They are being taped. And
when did that start?
Oh, years ago.
Okay.
But what I want to do is I want it on TV. PBS.
Right.
They were just on yesterday, Rick, was it, or day before yesterday, on School Matters, which was an excellent show. And if they can get on TV on Channel 10, we can get on Channel 10 and do these board meetings. Because many people don't know how to get on it. They don't know when it is. And they start at 4 o'clock. So, and that's when people are at work. And I want to change that to 6 o'clock. I don't care if we have to stay till 10, because we need the parent involvement. And parents want to say so much, but they can't because they're at work.
So parental involvement, and I see that lack in myself. I remember when they were doing the search for the new superintendent a few years ago. That's when Ruffles was his name?
He was the superintendent then.
Right, that's when they finally picked him, because the other candidate for superintendent decided to drop out the race, the one from New York City.
Yeah.
Well, while they were doing the search for the superintendent, there was hardly any parents in the forum. I hardly saw any parents showed up. I must have been at least 6 superintendent searches, and I don't even have a school child in the school district anymore.
Well, let me tell you what the problem is. Do you belong to a PTA with your child's school?
No, they're all grown.
Well, when they were in school.
I wasn't with the PTA, no.
No, you weren't. You need to join the PTA, but the problem we have in District B, not all schools have a PTA.
And could you explain what that is?
Parent-Teacher Association. And then they also have a program called MORE, M-O-R-E, for dads. It's kind of like the watchdog, getting the dads into the schools as well. District B does not have PTAs, PTOs.
And why is that?
Chris Garvey works full-time.
Wow.
And she has not had the availability to work with the Nevada PTA to get those things in. I've already been talking to them.
How many schools is in District B?
I asked Chris, in District B?
Correct.
Oh, we have 50,000 kids.
Okay.
So the number of schools, I think, is about 100 and some odd.
100 schools?
Yeah, it's the largest, District B is the largest.
So she hasn't even formed the PTA within the school district?
No, the PTA is supposed to be working with the trustees and vice versa, and it hasn't been done. So all our parents that want to do things with the PTAs, and if you read in the papers and you read on the website, all these wonderful principals and teachers are getting awards from the PTA. But they don't have a PTA at another school who has a great teacher. So where's the self-esteem of that teacher?
Rose, what's the vast majority of the geographical area that your district would cover?
North Las Vegas, East Las Vegas.
So do you think perhaps the PTA is not due to lack of interest or parental involvement, but maybe because of economic challenges?
No. No, we have so many parents at home. We have so many walk-to schools, and the parents walk the kids or drive the kids, and if they knew it was available and what the PTA is now doing, PTA is, I know, the national leader for PTA, for the nation.
So it basically just boils down to lack of leadership initiative. You feel that if a trustee were able to take over and resume that spearheading that effort, that you could get the community and parental involvement that you
absolutely
see in other districts.
PTA is different now. They're not just bake sales. They're now into the politics. They're now into curriculum. They're now in. They have input into the school district concerning the academics, the behavioral, the social, the emotional, the mental well-being of the student.
How do you feel? There are some candidates that have different platforms that they're running on for school board.
Yeah.
And some of the candidates are echoing that the school district is top heavy. They have four or five different assistant principals, but not enough teachers.
Correct.
They're paying for an administrative staff for making six figures, but the teachers in the classroom is only making $30,000. How do you feel about that?
Oh, it's totally wrong. We should be at the bottom looking at the teachers first. You know who knows more about the kids than anybody else? The janitor. I'm serious.
But aren't those same teachers the ones that eventually get promoted to assistant principals and then principals and then high-paid administrators themselves?
Yes, yes. And on School Matters, they were talking about one of the schools went from one star, because they have the five-star system, up to the five-star. And then what did they do? They took the principal and some of the teachers and put them into a lower one-star school. That's wrong, because now all these kids in the five-star schools are able to know their principal, know their teachers, feel more secure, want to go to school. And now they forget about kids' feelings when their principal is being taken out or their favorite teacher is taken out to go someplace else. You know, so what are they going to do with those principals and other teachers in the low-performing schools? Where are they going to send them?
How many deans should one grade level have per school?
Per school, one.
Because I hear that some schools have more than one per grade level.
Well, if it's high school, you need more.
Why is that?
Oh, my God, you got 2,000 kids.
Oh, a volume of kids and probably the problems associated with adolescents.
Yeah, you know, kids, even when they're 19, the brain still is developing.
Right.
So, you know, we have in the graduation rate, one of the big problems is credit deficient. And that is what the deans are supposed to be doing, and the counselors, is to make sure you're on track.
Okay.
And doing IEPs for special needs kids that are in the general ed environment.
Explain what an IEP is.
Individualized educational plan. And what I want to do when I become trustee, in the IEP, there's an assessment called present levels of performance. So if I tested you today, it would tell me what grade level you are in reading, math, and science. And it would also tell me where you stopped learning and where me as a teacher would have to start with you to bring you up to grade level. They're not using it. Okay. And it should be done in August, and it should be done in January. And they're doing something like that, but the problem here is they're doing that as an evaluation of that current teacher, and that's wrong because they stop learning. An 11th grader, I have probably 95% of my kids that I work with stop learning in the 4th grade. So they're going to blame the teacher that has them right now? No, I don't think so. So the present levels of performance is research-based. It's used for special education, and there's so many things in special education that should be used for, you know, the testing and everything, should be used for our general ed kids to see where they're at. They don't need an IEP saying you're special ed. They can put them on a 504 plan, which means you just need extra time, or you need to sit up front, that type of thing, or you need tutoring. That's a 504 plan. It's not real deep like the IEP. But we have many, many misdiagnosed kids, and I have to say, my forte is into ADHD, and we overdiagnose them. They're very well, I mean, so many are so overdiagnosed. And then we have those that have ADHD, and the fathers are terrible. They don't want a son with a disability. So they'll fight that every inch of the way.
I remember one of the candidates mentioned, that's running for trustee, that mentioned that the school district should just be in the teaching business and not in the transportation business or in the food services business.
Correct.
or in the other activities that the Clark County School District does in support of children in school. How do you feel about that?
I agree with it totally. The police department is a Category 2. They're in a lot of trouble right now, as you well know. Mm-hmm. And they're all kind of up in the air. They don't know what to do, and it's just a big mess. I have always felt that that should be privatized.
So do you think that the Clark County School Police should be dismissed and use Metro or North Las Vegas or Henderson?
I don't want to see them dismissed. I would like to see them as security guards in the schools.
How do they do that in
under
other communities?
But under Metro, so they don't lose their jobs. But no guns, no tasers.
How do they do it in other like-sized communities, perhaps, for instance, Washoe County or Los Angeles County?
They use regular police, Category 1.
So they use their local law enforcement?
Yes, they do.
And subcontract with them for services?
Yes.
And what about the transportation, the school bus?
Same thing with the transportation. It should be farmed out.
So, and the cafeteria as well?
Oh, definitely. I was really ticked off about a year ago.
And explain, why do you feel that way?
We're in the business of producing a product. The product is our child. And there's too much being done to pay off these bills for $14 million for pizza, which is true. I talked on that at the board. We have $9,000 that were spent on bullets. We had $400 spent on shirts for the police, of which the foundation reimburse the district for. The thing is just too big, and they should be separate companies that know what the heck they're doing, and they take care of the monies. We get the profit off of it, just like in the high schools. They all have these food courts. Well, those are run by McDonald's or Wendy's or something like that.
We're really feeding the kids healthy, aren't we?
You know, seriously we are. They're very, very picky on the things that are being fed to the kids. But what got me was, here was an opportunity when the guy that we have that does the food needed, hundreds of thousands of dollars to revamp the refrigeration area so to make it bigger. Now, we know the school district is lowering now. Lower kids. We don't have the boom we used to have. And here, what they should have said, because this contract was up, we are going to go out and rebid it because he wanted more money. There was their opportunity, and they passed it. They gave him as much money as he wanted.
What's your platform?
Whatever I do it for the kids, no matter what it is. As you know, I'm a very hard nose and of a gun. I shoot from the hip.
I'll know you'll stir things up, that's for sure.
Yeah. but when I stir things up, Steve, I have documentation. I have background. I've been around the block so many times, not with this district, but other districts where things don't work. And things do work. But if these trustees can't see the whole picture and see every step of the way that made the whole picture the way that it should be, then they're not worth being in there. Construction alone, I've been in construction for years. I know everything from underground to the top, to liens, to reading plans, to change orders and purchase orders, and what the total amount of the contract should be, plus the retainer and all this. Nobody there knows how to do it. I know purchasing. I know accounting. They did a tentative budget just this week. But guess what? There were no line items. No line items to tell you what this was all about. They gave you the big circles that look so pretty with blue and green and yellow. But on top of all of that, our chief financial officer, Jeff Weiler, he's colorblind. You know, so I'm going, wait. So everybody, I got everybody on the stick, and I said, you write to them and tell them that you want the line items. You don't want this thing. So we got 67 pages, and still, it was just a summary.
How do you feel about the current superintendent, Dwight Jones?
Believe it or not, when I was up in Colorado, he had some jobs up there. Excuse me. I have clients all over the United States. I had a couple clients up there. So I knew of Dwight. He had some problems with spending money. you know, take your credit card away, you know, Dwight. You can't do this anymore. He paid it all back. He did his restitution. That's over. That's done with. But he did a fantastic job. But and you have to remember, that was way before we decided to have look for a superintendent. So I knew of him years before. And I really, really, really like him.
So you would have approved?
Oh, absolutely. Okay. Absolutely. Right now, he and I have a agree to disagree on a very important issue, and I can tell you what that is, and that's on the police. I had a meeting with him. I showed him the documentation about the police department, what they were doing, what they were spending.
And you're talking about the Clark County School Police.
Clark County School District Police.
You know I'm up in arms with Metro, so.
Yeah. And, but anyway, I took all the information in confidence to show him. And like I say, I have documentation for anything I say. You want to know? I'll show it to you.
What's your position on homeschooling?
Love homeschooling.
Charter schools?
Charter school. I think what the district, I know what the district needs to do. We're 50th in education, truancy, and grad. And,
by the way, what's your plan to move us from the bottom? On break up the school district? Because that was one of the things that was also said.
You know what? We're almost there. We have regional superintendents in different areas. It's like they're kind of setting it up or kind of evolved to set it up. And yes, I think we need to split up this district. We're too, too big. And the kids are not getting the attention that they need.
Should children go to schools that they're zoned for, or should they, if they don't like that school, should they be able to go to a different school that's not in their zone?
They should be able to go to the school that is for the purpose of what they want to do.
Okay.
So if they're in technical and they live off of Civic Center Drive and they got to come all the way up here, then there's the issue of transportation. But the kids should go where their needs are. Homeschooling, definitely. And the reason I say that is because we're in such a mess right now in the academics, the truancy, and the graduation rate. Let's let our kids go. Give them the vouchers. Let them go to the private schools. Let them be homeschooled until we can get our mess cleared up. And they will come back. They will come back. But it's going to be 5 to 7 years before that happens.
Kathleen, do you have anything for Rose?
I do have a few questions for Ms. Rose before we close up her interview. You did a fantastic job today, by the way. Congratulations.
Thank you.
If I were in your district, I would certainly vote for you.
Thank you.
In closing, one final note for you on the budgetary problems that the school district is facing. And I agree with you, Rose. Bigger government has never demonstrated to be better or effective government. And most of what you're talking about here, whether it goes back to quality of education, or it goes back to managing employees or what have you, really has to do with the budget constraints that are already in place that we foresee that there will be more of. They're talking about doing yet another 10 to 15% cut across the board. What are your plans or your ideas, should you be elected, in helping to secure the fiduciary responsibilities for the district and moving forward with yet even tighter budget constraints over the next couple of years?
Forensic audit.
I've heard about that.
Yes,
and that,
I've.
People have wanted it for years. I'm pushing it. We will get it. You got to remember, I have to have 6 other people agree with me. But this is outside audit of the people that the district does not know. And I have already investigated 2 or 3 that I would like to have come in
to do that. You want to go back and look at the past spending, as you mentioned with this previous contract with the refrigeration company, and see if that spending is justifiable and just really start.
Well, I already have. I've done that for 14 years. When I see something wrong with the agenda on the purchase orders, I'm so used to it, I can see exactly where money is being taken out and used for another department. I could tell you exactly where they are. And I go before the board and I give them the paperwork and I said, here it is. It's right in front of you. Do not pull that from the agenda. Pull that purchase order from the agenda. Here's the documentation. Here's this. Here's that. And they don't do it. They won't listen to me.
Well, Rose, is that it, Kathleen?
That was, yes, thank you very much.
Rosemore, thank you for coming on the show. We appreciate it.
You're a wonderful man and the wonderful things that you do for our vets.
Thank you very much, Rosemore. That's Rosemore.
Good luck to you.
Thank you.
She is a candidate for
District B.
District B.
As in
Clark
boys.
County School Board Trustee. And she's also a Veterans in Politics endorsement recipient, so we encourage all the Veterans in Politics members and listeners to go out and vote for Rose Moore. Tell your friend, tell your neighbors. We need to put Rose Moore as the new Clark County School Board Trustee in office. This is Steve Sanson and Kathleen Vermillion with Veterans in Politics, but don't go away, folks. Kathleen Vermillion has a few announcements, so we're going to take one commercial break, and we're going to come right back to our announcements.
Thank you, my love. Thanks.
Hello, my name is Steve Sanson. I'm the president of Veterans in Politics International. This country and state are in trouble with budget cuts, unemployment, foreclosures, teacher shortage, dropout rates, terrorism, and a loss of military service members. The outcome of this election will profoundly affect families, both military and non-military. Military men and women are dying for other countries to have the right to vote. As a former member of the United States Marine Corps and the Army, I know how important it is to keep the voters informed. Log on to the website veteransinpolitics.com. All Americans of voting age need to not only vote, but research your choices. The Veterans in Politics organization has taken a proactive approach to supporting candidates who will have the courage to protect all of our freedoms and our Constitution. Visit our website at veteransinpolitics.com. Don't just talk about who you support. Research your choices and vote.
This is Steve Sanson, Kathleen Vermillion with Veterans in Politics. Take it away, Kathleen.
One quick announcement for our veterans out there listening. The Henderson Municipal Court held its first graduation ceremony for its Veterans Court Initiative, which was started by Judge Mark Stevens, who's a veteran himself. The court is an alternative sentencing program for military veterans charged with misdemeanor crimes while struggling to readjust to civilian life. If any of you out there are needing those services or have found yourself in a runway with Henderson Law Enforcement, you can certainly call Mr. Judge Stevens for assistance through his new programming. It's been very successful. He's had over 15 graduates from the program just in 2011, and that phone number is 267-2405. And thank you, Steve, for allowing me to co-host today. It was a pleasure, and it was certainly a lot of fun. I appreciate the opportunity.
Thank you, Kathleen. We got to do this again, huh, Irma? Yeah, see, Irma likes you.
I like Irma, too.
This is Steve Sanson and Kathleen Vermillion with Veterans in Politics. Until next week.
Opinions expressed on this program were those of the hosts and guests and did not necessarily reflect those of Vegas All Net Radio, its affiliates, or its parent company.